Ayo, back at it again, doing me. Peace and love reflections. Today's Tuesday, and sorry to run about a little late, but we're getting it started. Y'all, this ain't got nothing to do with the class, but it like to sleep in complete silence. But shut up, man. It's all it'll do. It is shut up in a little bit. Okay, so today's class is about, where'd my board go? Today's common sense class is about a follow-up on our credit cards, and we're also going to talk about investing. So the points of today: first, we must understand a credit card. Hear me, go. Be with your friend. To further understand a credit card, we have to further understand why they call it credit and what credit is that we accumulate throughout our lives. And when we go to a credit bureau and we say we want a credit card, we say, can I have one based on my credit? Well, how do they determine whether your credit is good enough for a credit card and whether your credit is bad enough for a credit card? I don't know why I just did that. But sorry, you guys, it's backwards. But I'm going to try to write backwards to try to do it. All right, so don't ignore this. This is just my highlights. So when you have a credit score about 750 and up, and then you have a credit score of 540 and down, this is known as the bad credit, and this is known as, we're gonna just put up a thumb. Sorry, but that's a good credit. It's supposed to be a thumb. Thumbs up, but whatever. So, when you have a credit score of 750, you're known as in the green, and then when you're in the red, it's 500 and below. So, when you go to a credit bureau and you say, my credit score is between this, this lets them know that you are trying to grow your debt and you're not trying to decrease your debt. So this means that you are in a good spot to give you debt. We went through this earlier. Credit cards are just energy transferred into money and transferred into invisible numbers, and they give you debt. So when you're in the middle of these two numbers, that tells them that, yes, give this person some money, but not too much money, but give them enough to make them feel like their number really matters and that their numbers, their credit score really is important to them. And they'll get a pretty much, this person here most likely will get a $5,000 credit card to maybe about $8,000. No, that's actually too much. They'll actually get a $2,000, and then this person about $5,000. That's how much they'll normally get, about $2,000 to $5,000. This person here is lucky to get $500. And the minimum that they'll get, that's about that, they lucky to get $500. This person here is lucky to get all of this and some, but the cap would be $10,000. That's how they pick which numbers you get. Now, the question is, how much money is this? All this is debt. All this that they're doing, and they're increasing you and they're putting you in debt. So when you say, my credit score is good, they say, great, you are chosen to have more debt. When you say, my credit score is bad, you're chosen to have no increase in debt because they know that you are already in debt. You feel me? So you're not having to develop more debt because you're already in it. That means some bills you're not paying already, you're feeding into the debt monster. Some bills you already said you ain't gonna pay, or you dipped on something, your rent was overdue, you got kicked out, you in debt. So they're not gonna bother you. They more likely to give you a credit card here to put you further into debt, but they won't give you that much money to put you further into debt, but they will allow you to get money to put you further in debt. This person here, you'll notice that your credit cards, when you're in this in-between realm, you notice that it's hard for you to find a credit card that actually fits you that's more than the credit card that you already have. If you already have a $2,000 credit card and you say you in the in-between, they'll be like, well, we can give you $2,000 or $1,000. They do that to you because it's like they don't know if you're going to try to get rid of your debt or you're going to try to increase your debt. So they're on the fence with you just as you're on the fence with them. So over here you have the people with the 750 and up. You feel me? These people say, I got good credit. I haven't been really doing it. They want to put you deeper in debt. So by telling you, you can get $1,000 of credit. That says this is how much, because you could lose your job. Because your 750 is based on if you pay your bills, based on if you're renting, based on your livelihood. But at any point, this 750 can be a 540. And through that, through your life, you have ups and downs. And they said, well, we're willing to give you 10,000, right? Hush. We're willing to give you 10,000 just to keep you in debt. Because again, last video, we talked about how credit cards is just a scheme for you to get into debt. Okay, so now, why do they give you what is your credit score? Your credit score helps them understand how your mind works. Your area is more like a survey. If there's a bunch of people around you and they're all 750 credit, that means they're all out of debt. And that means that place needs to be hit up for resources. That means that place needs to be tapped. Pretty much. Wherever you live, if everybody around you have a great credit score, your land needs to be raped and savaged. Your trees need to be knocked down because you're not feeding the debt monster. Your place, and if you have a 750, if you look around, your mortgage, your houses, home owners association is prominent where you are because those people constantly want to keep giving you fees. They want to constantly keep giving you taxes. They want to constantly keep dragging you deeper into debt. So if you living in the 750 environment, know that your environment is being threatened because you are no longer feeding the debt monster. However, if you're in the $550 points credit, look around you. Your friends and your family are all struggling. Your schools are struggling. Your streets are pothole filled. Churches are everywhere. Everybody's car is either being worked on by them. There's a tire shop in every corner. Your stores, they're like 5 Walmarts in your area. Why is this? Because they trying to feed you into the debt mentality and into the debt monster even deeper. But at the same time, they don't want you to spread anywhere else. They want you, this is like, this right here is the 750 people. They got big houses, garages, you know. The 540 people, they not only in a house, but they, no, I'm sorry. They not even in a house. Let's take that off. The 540 people, this is what y'all look like. Y'all are apartments. 750 people get houses. Y'all even get a yard, driveway. 550 people, y'all get apartments. Why? Because they know if you surround yourself with people that's in debt, you ain't gonna ever get out of debt. And y'all gonna keep trying to find schemes and more schemes and scheme after scheme to find yourself out of that debt. And those schemes gonna try to get you in debt. Those schemes that you find, they put you in more of and put you more in debt than they actually get you out of. So they know that this is what y'all are doing here. Gathering yourself in debt more. So they do very little to keep that mindset going. Over here, they want you to keep saying, I want to keep up with the Joneses. My house is falling apart and I want somebody to pay for it. My children need better schools. I want somebody to pay for it. This is what they do to you. This is the mentality. It's called feed the beast false cookies and things. I don't know why I drew that. My mom was just going... This one is keep the mentality going. Feed the beast, keep the mentality. And in the in-between, you have nomadic people. You have people who have duplexes. People that live with each other. You have college degree people who just trying to find themselves right here in the middle, because these people can go either direction. And this is to feed the beast of debt. This one is to keep the mindset of debt, the beast of debt. You keep the mindset, feed the beast. When you have a 750 credit and above, and when you have a 546 credit, you get a house here, you get apartments here. Now, when you're in the in-between, you realize that you could have either one. So what they want to do, they want to get you in touch with the beast. You have a choice here in the in-between. So when you have a 600 credit and people around you have 600 credit, y'all are always thinking. Y'all are always thinking. Y'all saying things like, what can we do? How can we increase ourselves? How can we work together? This is the time people work that work together are. They're in the 600 range of credit. That's where they are. They're in the 600. Because in that area, you're not saying I'm better than you or I'm less than you. You're in the in-between. So therefore, you have a mentality of building. You have a mentality of growing. You have an entrepreneurial mind. But your entrepreneurial mind can lead you into despair or it can lead you in false hope. But see, if you stay in the in-between, you stay balanced. See, even in money, even with credit cards, even in credit, you have a balance. You have a balance. You can choose to be super rich with credit, these invisible numbers called credits, or you can be less in and feel sad and feel in that mentality and not go anywhere and be stagnated and keep, they feeding the beast, you guys. They use your hopes and dreams and your mentality to feed the beast of death. Now that we understood that part, because this is just a follow-up of last time. Okay, so now we got to talk about when we have a credit card. It's about $30,000 to $45,000, then there's a most likely great chance that you will pay this $10,000 off. But these people right here, see these people right here? Those people right here will actually be given more credit cards, and they'll be called all the time to ask them if they want to increase their debt, if they want help with their debt. These people will be the ones that the credit cards love to come and get to increase and feed the debt monster. And they will not only end up with $10,000 started off in the year, but they'll end up with $20,000 in debt, which literally is not even matching what their income is. These people will not most likely not be chased down and asked to buy new credit cards or chased into asking some ridiculous way to buy a car, because they can pay off this debt and that's not feeding the beast. These people here would be taxed more, okay? You either get taxed or you get credit card debt. These are the two things and the two ways they get us, because we have to all feed the debt monster, because I don't know what the debt monster is, but it exists. So if your income is, what is this like, almost 40%, if your debt is 40% of your income, that's what I'm trying to say, then you most likely need to not buy any credit cards. You need to not take your money and just give it to fast ways of enjoyment. You need to, these are drugs, alcohols, shopping splurges, traveling all the time. If your debt is $10,000 and your money to come in is in this in-between, that is not your, this is not where you want to be, because this is going to keep them hounding you and tricking you into feeding off your body so that you can continue to feed this debt monster and continuously not being able to go anywhere. So what you want to do is say, you know what, if you don't want me to go anywhere and you want me to stay in debt, then put a brake on your life and say, okay, I'll give you what you want so that I can actually take this $10,000. Because if you only make $5,000 to $25,000 and you're giving it $10,000, you literally are just making, this is what you look like, negative $5,000 and to $15,000. That's what you really look like. This is what you really look like. If your credit, if you owe $10,000 to the credit card company, you don't make that much. You negative, and you make $5,000 a year. This is people just on that 9-to-5 Walmart shopping ass butt money, versus the $25,000 that's actually $15,000 if you owe this much. You may most likely work two jobs, or you go to school and work one job. But really, your income comes down to this $15,000. And that's nothing, because you literally have worked your ass off to pay off a debt, to give back some money you already owe, that they're continuously calling you to ask for more money. But if you had, what we said 30 earlier, if you had $30,000 to $45,000 and you had a $10,000 debt, you feel me? Your real debt looks, you really making 20. And then you really making 30. You living a pretty comfortable life here, you feel me? Because in this understanding, you can still pay your bills, you can still eat, you can still buy the nice clothes, you can still do these things, but the things you buy are extremely taxed. The places you live is extremely taxed. So that's how you have to feed your debt monster. But good news, you won't have this. If you're making this, then you won't have that. But if you're making that previous amount, you are gonna be your debt gonna increase. Your taxes won't increase, but your debt will increase, and that's how you feed your debt monster. So what we learned here is that we all have to feed a debt monster. If you live in this type of city environmental credit life, the only way to not feed the debt monster is to first break off the snacks, take off the food that's feeding the debt monster. And what feeds your credit debt is your ego. Remember, the ego makes you pay. And understand and acknowledge when your ego is taking over, because your income minus the things you need should equal out your profit. And whatever your profit is divided by your savings and your wants. You can square that for investments, and therefore you can increase your income. If you can't seem to increase your income that way, then somewhere down the line, you're messing up. So, increase income, not debt. All right, so yeah, that's what we were talking about. Increasing our income and not debt. So, how do we increase our income and not our debt? So, first, credit cards. What we want to do is stop getting them. Okay, that's the first part. In credit cards, we want to stop getting credit cards. Student loans. What we want to do with student loans, we want to understand how they work. Okay? And understand that the student loans are a sum of how much we can't accumulate with the understanding that we have now. But if you understand how to get the things you're trying to get, say you need a law degree, this, that, and the other, what you want to do before you go into the schooling system, you want to surround yourself with people in that area first, so they can help you manifest the things you need in life in order to get that dream job before you spend all your money and your time getting student loans and giving grants. Most people, they tell you go to college, and then if you go to college, you'll get these dream jobs. What they don't tell you is that first, surround yourself with people that are doing this. Let them talk to you about the ins, outs, and the trades, and then jump into it. Because by the time you finish talking to them, it should help you manifest the income, and it should help you manifest the tricks so that you can get into that position, so that your student loans are not that much. So what you want to do is decrease student loans. How do you decrease student loans? Well, you can be around people. Another thing is just not go to college. I'm not saying that college is bad and some of us need college. Some of us can't just go to the library and gain the knowledge. You feel me? Some of us just can't talk to people and gain the knowledge. You feel me? Some of us aren't born and it's inherited to us. We actually have to go. But if you look through your options, what can you do for yourself before you have to spend all your life repaying yourself for the knowledge that you've given yourself? Knowledge is free. So student loans are pretty much tax knowledge. They literally wiggle a book in front of you, tell you the library is free, and then tell you to come pay for it. They tell you the internet is abundant in information, but you have to pay for the internet. And the internet is abundant in all information that we have right now, right? This is what I don't understand. But college takes you like 35 grand just to do like just to do a whole like 4 year of college. You got like, you're grand in debt. Hold on, I gotta let out this animal for you. And credit, okay, so like, explain to me that. If the internet has all the information that a college or university has, then why do I pay $14.99 a month for it, and then I'm in debt to go to college for like 35 grand? You feel me? What sense does that make, you guys? Because these things are traps. Your library is free. Your internet is cheap. They all have all the information in the colleges and the universities. But yet, when you go to the universities and the colleges, just because of easiness and comfort and the people are there to give you the information right there, and it's based on what you want to find, just like the internet, they charging you grand after grand after grand just to do this. You have to get a grant, and you have to pay it back, and then you have to get a loan. You got to pay it back. The loan is now double because they got in. You got all these problems here, and you could have got the information for free. If we turn ourselves into the mindset and say, college is great for those who need it, but I believe in myself, I'm going to get the information out there that's already free, and I'm going to just establish my own business, be in my own business right now for the things I want in life, I'm actually going to save myself a lot, and my income is going to increase. Because not only am I now investing in myself, I am taking my own mind and I'm thinking, how am I thinking? Because I'm not thinking about, how can I take the easy route? How can I make this easier for me? I'm thinking, how can I let this work for me now and in the future? So that's how you take your student loans and you help yourself decrease debt. Because you don't have to take a student loan, you guys. The information is out there free. It's easy information. The books is easy to get. The easy information. I'm pretty sure on Craigslist is the books. You can get the books from people. If you're surrounding yourself with people that are in that area from the get-go, your area of learning, your area of what you want to do from the get-go, then they'll be able to pass down books to you. They'll be able to pass down knowledge to you. They'll be able to pass out tricks and trades for you. All right, so we got that part. What's another way to decrease debt? Gas, vehicle debt. Some of us keep paying people to work on our cars. So we got maintenance. Decrease maintenance. Maintenance on our house, maintenance on our car, hair maintenance, skin maintenance, doctor maintenance, dental maintenance. These things are maintenance, you feel me? And if we could learn how to either be around people that are good at these things or learn these tricks and trades ourselves and work on ourselves. If you fill yourself with good foods and information, the information will allow you to keep your health up. If you understand how your teeth work and keep them clean, healthy, I believe that the teeth are really just where all your nutrients are housed. And when your body is lacking certain nutrients, it takes from what I call the storage units. And your teeth are the storage units of your life. And when you don't have certain nutrients and certain vitamins, your teeth start to decay. They're not really decaying and they're not really dying. It's just the building blocks of your teeth, with all the nutrients you have, all the vitamins you have that are stored here, they get taken away. So if you understand, if you keep all your nutrients at a certain level, all your vitamins at a certain level, your teeth should stay in. That's why we get children with all those metal caps on their teeth. They're vitamin deficient. They're nutrient deficient. It's not about sugar intake. It's not about cholesterol. It's not about all that sugar intake. It's not about acid or anything anymore. If you really think about it, look at your teeth and say, how do your teeth build? Your teeth build when your nutrition and your vitamins build. When you were a baby and you were just having breast milk or you were just having formula, you didn't have any teeth. And as you gained formula, as you gained breast milk, as you gained all these different nutrients and things, fruits and vegetables, you notice your teeth started to grow. When you've hit a certain level that your mouth can only take so much and it wants to upgrade and evolve, you lose those teeth and you get an upgraded system. And these systems are allowed to keep those teeth going, which is building more nutrients, they're allowed to hold more nutrients. That's pretty much what I believe that the teeth are. So if you can understand that understanding, you can realize you don't need to go to the dentist, because the dentist is just there to put, to give you false hope. Just give you false hope. They could clearly tell you, hey, you're lacking nutrients. Hey, these things will help. Fruits and vegetables and herbs are outside and they're free, you guys. Nature gives us abundant working for free. So you got to gain knowledge. If you can gain knowledge, again, you can go to the libraries. You can go around dentists around you. They hang out everywhere. You got bars. You got streets. You got dentist conventions. You got the internet. You got all these places to find free information for the things you need. Okay? So just get out there and get it done. Herbalists, they're out there. Herbalist conventions are out there. Festivals for natural living is out there. This shit is free most of the time. Go out there and that's how you can get your help. Maintenance work. YouTube, you guys. Vehicle maintenance, YouTube. That's really all I gotta say. Is you wanna keep paying. Let me break that down for you. Your vehicle. Hold on. Your vehicle. So I'm a terrible driver, but your vehicle, right, causes you debt. How does it do that? Because when it breaks down, you automatically to go to somebody. This somebody will take a part that costs $15. Okay, that part costs $15. All of a sudden, you know how much that part costs you when you take that part to somebody else? They put $200 on top of it, minimum. So when you take your car and you take it to somebody for a $15 part change, they charge you $200. You spend $215 on a $15 part. Now you got to stop whatever you spent your money on, you saved your money on, you were going to spend your money on, you got to give it back to your car. When you could have actually learned on YouTube or learned from a friend or just got a book from the library to understand how to fix that one part and what it is, you could have just spent $15 instead of $215, you feel me? And we got all this knowledge here. When we do this, okay, tire rotation. Do you know how long it takes to do your own tire rotation? You literally just need a jack, and you may need like two bricks. Oh my gosh.
Stay in or stay out?
Okay, sorry about that. Tire rotations. Tire rotations literally take maybe an hour of your time. You make, most likely, these are all the things that I have when I'm doing my own tire rotation. I get a jack. I get a, what they call it? Not a look, what they, crowbar, not a crowbar, but what they call it? Fuck, my brain just went dead. You got the jack, and then you get a four-way, which it has a little, it has the hubcap releases on it. What they call that thing? You got a jack, you got a crank. It looks like this. I just call it a four-way. But it looks like that, and you put it on the wheels, and you release the nuts off the wheels. So you just need that, you need a jack, and you need two bricks. An hour of your time. All you do is you do one tire at a time. You take the tire off. You take the front off or the back off, whichever one you want to jack up. Put the bricks behind the back two. Take one off. Undo it. You feel me? And then you put... Oh, and you need jack stands. Jack stands are actually cheap. They cost like $20. So all this right here... All this right here, this most likely came with your vehicle. This should came with your vehicle. If not, you can get one for $20. You can get jack stands for about the same $20. And some bricks. You can get the bricks free. They're everywhere on the ground. You just pick one up. Put one behind your tire. You literally spend like less than freaking, less than $50 worth of stuff. And you can change your tire back to back. And it takes tire rotation. It's $30 every time you go to Walmart to have somebody do it. $30 times, because you should do tire rotations after a certain amount of miles. That's about four times a year you do tire rotations. If you pay $30 four times a year, you have $120 that you spent somebody else to do something that could have took you an hour to do yourself. So what you want to do is when you do your own tire rotations, I'm going to get into that right now. I'm about to go into maintenance. That's not today. Sorry, y'all. I'm getting deep in that shit because I've been wanting to teach people about car maintenance because that shit is very important, because maintenance on your vehicle is one of our main things that decrease our income, because we're so busy using it to increase our income and we're wearing it out. And it's costing us money. We're not really investing enough into it. We're investing money into nice cars to give it to someone else to work on the cars, and then using that same car to bring money. And all you're doing is making money to give somebody to fix it. This is the spectrum that you're doing when you should be doing this. This me and my increase. This me my increase is a triangle. But when you're just using your increase and when using your money to go from vehicle to someone else fix it, there ain't no you in between. It's just a constant straight line. What you're trying to make is a triangle so your income can increase, because a grid is like this when you're on the graph. It's like this, and that's how you can do the increase graph like that. But if you're just going in a straight line, how can you make a graph? So think about that. Think of all the things you're doing. So maintenance on yourself, maintenance on your body, maintenance on your car, maintenance on your house. Learn how to clean your own house. Learn how to fix your own house. Home Depot is there. You got all the parts, all the tools you need, you guys. YouTube is a friend. That's how you can also decrease your debt, increase your income. So these are different ways. Better jobs. You can have a better job, but is it going to take away from your time on building on yourself? Is that going to take away your health? Is that going to take away your is that going to add more maintenance to your vehicles, to your home? What is it going to do? You think about the jobs you do, and then think about how does that affect you, and is it truly increasing your income in the long run? So, what we want to do is when we go to our new jobs and we want to have the jobs that we have, and we do these things, we need to be investing. So we went through it. Remember, when you have income, you minus your needs, and you equal to profit. And you divide all that up with the savings and the wants. And you can score all that with your investments. Now, what can you do to invest in yourself? Investments are basically extra money that you put aside into different places that's going to accumulate increase in your life, or accumulate increase in your finances, or accumulate increase in somewhere in your mind. Earlier I talked about car maintenance. If you spend $50 buying jack stands, buying crowbars, buying all these things that's gonna help you fix your truck and your car, that's $50. But divide that in all the times you're gonna use it. You literally gained all your money back. You even gain more money by not giving money to people who can do that for you. You feel me? So instead of paying the $215 to somebody, the $215 goes literally back to your own pocket because it never left your pocket. So therefore, you're not taxing yourself somewhere else, because pretty much that's what you're doing. You're literally buying vehicles, having someone else fix it, and they having someone else is pretty much taking taxes out of your energy. Let's not do that. So when we invest in ourselves, it has to increase our livelihood. It has to increase something in our life. So, and when you work on your own car, it increases your money because you're not giving it to someone. It increases your mind because you learned a new skill. It increased your time, because some of us, when we have our cars looked at, they take our cars for days and we got to stop our lives to fix around that. So we increasing our time, we do it ourselves. We're able to help other people and friends, because sometimes when you learn how to do a trade, your friends say, I don't have time, but I'm willing to pay you. They'll pay you to learn something, to do what you already learned. And since that happens, you've now increased your finances. You've helped your friend, and hopefully you use your mindset to help your friend help themselves. But if they don't want to help themselves, they can at least still come to you and help you increase your mindset, your income, and your own skill levels. The more and more you practice over something and do something, you increase your skills. So you're increasing yourself. So when you just started with these jacks, these stands and these brakes and stuff, and you know you've increased your income. This is just learning, you guys. Learning increases your income. It also helps you invest in yourself, because you've invested in yourself when you buy parts to do things for yourself. Hammers. When you buy tools to work on your own house, you never know when you're going to need them again. That's investing in yourself. When you pay for the internet to gain more knowledge, investing in yourself. When you buy a bike, you're investing in yourself. When you When you buy clothes and you buy shoes, that's great and all. That's like 1% of investment in yourself, because sometimes you may buy a suit, but you wear that suit once every blue moon. Or you can buy a suit, and that suit gets you a better job in the future. That's investing in yourself. But if you're not, if you don't aspire to that new job that you bought that suit for, then pretty much that investment in that suit is pretty much zero, because it's just sitting in your closet and you're not doing anything with it. So now you've lost money because you're not doing anything with it. Everything that you do in this world should be investing in not just your finances, but your mental, your emotional, your spiritual, and your physical. When I say invest in yourself, I mean all of these things, not just financial, you guys. These are things we have to understand. Okay, so financial things. How can I help you more in investing in yourself financially? If you don't know where you are financially, I actually work with my econ, and we help people with their credit score. We help people with their income, understand where they could spend their money, where they don't have to spend their money, where they could increase their money and savings, where they could pretty much balance themselves out so that they can get to a level where they're no longer giving out their money but increasing. So it's called My Econ, and I'll leave the link in the description. All the information is there for you to understand. And it's pretty simple. We literally just show you how to take the money you have already and use it to better yourself. How else is another one? Oh, ByobFx. That's where we learn how to do A1 technology. And there are courses and there are people there to help you understand how Forex works. Forex is pretty much the new stock. It's not stock because it's a whole different realm. But it's taking the understanding of money, Bitcoin, and technology, matching it into one, and giving you another way to increase your income. And I say do it because right now, technology is the new dollar. And if you're still investing in the dollar, you're not really investing in yourself, because the dollar is going down every day. But if you invest in what is growing right now, which is technology, then that's a bigger investment for your future, because technology is constantly growing. We get new ways of understanding, new things, new technology, you guys. So invest in it while you can. I'm going to put the link in the bio for that too. And we talked about schools, how they get us. But pretty much, when you invest in something, make sure that even if you... Okay, the percentage of investments. If you invest $50 in something that's supposed to make you money, make sure that $50 is supposed to make you $200. That's what you want to see. If you invest in something and it costs $50, make sure when you add that $50, it turns into $200. Not turn into $100. Because, I mean, it can, but what you want to do is your goal is to get it to be $200. If it gets to be $100, if it gets to be $75, that's still good, but what you want it to do is go strive for the $200. If you invest in something for $200, how much do you think you want it to be? Because if 50 was four of these, you would want this to be, what, eight? So if you invest in something for $200, you want it to be 800. Right now, BYOB, which is the Forex company I work with, I invested $50, and I tried to get y'all to invest in it with me while it was $50. And now I'm trying to turn my $50 into, that's what I'm trying to turn mine into. I'm trying to turn my 50, take my 50, and I'm trying to turn it into 100,000. That's what I'm trying to turn mine into. But in a realistic understanding, my $50, I know 10 grand is what I'm trying to do. 10 grand, what am I going to do with that? I'm just going to get rid of all of my credit card debt. Okay? That's it. That's all I'm going to do. Because if I could take away that credit card debt, I could take away giving my money out, and I can literally take all that money and put it back where I want it to go, which is building myself a house on some land somewhere. Maybe not in this country, maybe not in the state, but I'm building me my own mental picture that I give myself a tree house in the middle of a bunch of trees, just surrounded by my own self, stores may be, I want to say, 25 miles away, and it's just me. It's me, my dog, and whoever else I have companionship for, because, like, there is somebody, but it's just, like, not. Anyway, so that's what I want. So I've invested right now to do the course. It's no longer $100. It was $100, and y'all didn't care. Now it's gonna be $197, I believe. I think that's what it is. And that $197 can put you in the line with me. Because take that $197 and make it into $100,000. Because that's the goal. We're trying to take this course and do this because that's how I'm investing in myself. When you invest in yourself, understand that whatever you put in, it needs to make you four times that amount. If you put in $10, somebody say, it only takes you $10 to join my group. And if you join my group, then I can have you making $200 extra a month. And you say, doing what? And they say, all you need to do is spend 20 hours a week doing calls. 20 hours a week at a 9-to-5 job. So if you was getting paid $10 an hour, $20, you're supposed to make $200. But times that by four, that's $800 that you would have been making on a 9-to-5 hour job. But now they just want to make you $200 extra on your already money. Does that make sense to you? No. So you don't want to invest your $10, your $15 in people who just want to make you $200 a month extra. Because and they want more hours out of you than an actual 9-to-5-hour job. They're taking your intellect and they're confusing you and making you feel like just because they say more money added on to you, that it's not as bad as the action on another 9-to-5-hour job. So what you want to do is get away from those type of schemes. When they say things like, you can do it on your own whenever you feel like it. All you have to do is give $50 now. We'll teach you how to do it. Once we teach you how to do it, if you can have somebody else do it and you can teach them, that's great. But also, because you got to understand that part. Also, on top of you teaching and referring people, doing the work, you get paid. See, the pyramid scheme is everywhere, y'all. Stop telling me about, I think that's a pyramid scheme and it's a pyramid scheme. You live in it if you work for a company. Your company's got somebody at the top. They got people at the middle. They got people at the bottom. That is a pyramid, you guys. So let's fuck off with that. But when you go into what they call a pyramid scheme, it goes, give me money. Give me your money. Refer other people to give you their money, okay? And then, therefore, they'll refer people to give them money. It goes like this. It looks just like that. Give me money to go refer people, and then them people refer people, and they'll give you money. That's a pyramid scheme. There was no interest. There's just literally people are exchanging money in that sequence. You understand? This is a no. You do not want to do anything like that because that's literally a waste. You got to convince people to do it. But if they say, give me money, okay? We give you education, okay? I'm like, all right, get a book. All right, they give me education. They give you education, and then all of a sudden, you take that education that they give you, you tell other people. Okay? After you tell other people about it, these other people are going to ask you, well, what do you do? Well, with that education, they're going to actually have you doing the work. All right? You're going to give them money, they give you education, you do the work, and you tell people. This increases your income. And then when these people tell other people about your work, you get money and they get money. And then everybody's happy. This is a better way of working. And this is a better way of investing in yourself than just actually taking off the work part. And it says, give me money. I give you some way we doing it, whatever we doing it. You tell somebody else and then you make money off of them telling somebody else. And then the cycle continues. That's a terrible thing. A spiral is just like a toilet bowl flushing, bro. It just goes swoosh, swoosh, and it's gone. You don't want to be part of that. You want to be part of education yourself and then educating others, doing the work, showing them, and let the cycle continue. That's better. That's why I like working with ByobFx, because what they told me to do was they told me to give them some money, okay? I gave them some money. They gave me the education. Then I told people. And then after I told those people, I even gained more education. And after I gained more education, I was doing, while I was doing this though, let me be honest with you. I was doing the work while I was getting the education. So what I'm doing is I gave them money, they gave me education, I'm doing the work, I told other people, I got more education, and now these other people are giving me opportunities to increase my income, and therefore I am building. This is not a pyramid scheme, you guys. This is better because you're exchanging energy. See how it's more of a cycle, peace and love? See how it's more of a cycle? Then if you were just giving money, telling people, and then they tell more people, and somehow these people give you money, and neither one of you guys did work. This is a pyramid scheme. There's no work involved. There's no knowledge exchange. There's literally just, hey, give me $150, I give you $25 of that, and you go tell somebody else to give you $50, you give me $10 of that, and you can keep the rest, and you just keep doing it. That is a pyramid scheme. It's almost as bad as when they say, I'm at the top, I'm making $100,000 a year, but people underneath me are making $75,000 a year. You're barely making $25, but if you give me more work, I'll put you up at the $75,000 yearly income, and then you might be able to get the $100, but you might. If you gotta get more people at the bottom to move yourself. That's an ultimate pyramid scheme. Think about it. If there's anybody at the top, the Fibonacci code teaches us 3, 6, 9, bro. So if there's somebody at the top of anything that you do, and not everybody is equal, and they're gaining the same thing of their own accord and their own knowledge, then you win a pyramid scheme. Think about it. Ask yourself what truly is a pyramid scheme. Is it really when you say things like, give me money and I'm going to give you knowledge to help yourself get more money so you can teach other people? Or is it give me money to go tell somebody how to give you money? Like, think about what it is how do you invest in yourself? Think about it. That's what I'm trying to get y'all to see. Like, we've been programmed so much to think that the pyramid scheme was bad, but that was just to confuse you, because the real ultimate pyramid scheme was what you were already doing, which is working in 9-to-5-hour jobs. Somebody at the top, somebody in the middle, supervisor, director, manager, you. You got all these problems, and you don't even see it because they've been telling you that if you worked outside of that pyramid that they gave you, that scheme, then you are going against the flow of the business, the nature of the business. But really what they're saying, if you go outside of that, you'll start to understand how it actually works. Then you'll actually start to progress. You'll start to increase your finances. And again, in the beginning of the video, we talked about feeding the debt beast. You ain't feeding the debt beast if you learn how to get out of it. Let's take in a different perspective. The perspective is the ancient pyramids were built. Why do we not still build buildings in pyramid form? Facts. If the pyramids were so great, why do we not do any of our buildings that way? We do, but we use them as casinos. We use them as teepees and tents. But think about it, you guys. If the pyramids were so great, so sturdy, so eco-friendly, so this and that, why do we build them in our houses in boxes? Why do we build our businesses in large rectangles? Why do we build them the way that we build them? Because when you build a building like this, everybody in between pretty much has an equal understanding of how the business is going. When the business is built like this, like a pyramid, you have somebody at the top. It's only one person can sit at the top. Only a few people can sit there. Only so on and so forth. You see how not It's not an understanding level. When you build a round house, you got different structures, but at least nobody's at the top. The top is actually maybe like two or three people, as you can see. But these are different shapes that we can build our mentality. So when you think about different businesses and how to invest your money, think about who is at the top. Is there one person at the top, or is there plenty of people saying, hey, let's all help you. Let's all build together. Let's all build up. Because if there's just one person at the top, then guess what? You win a pyramid scheme. If there's one person telling you what to do, and he don't got nobody he answer to, he don't got nobody he turn to, or she don't got nobody to answer to, that she ain't got nobody to turn to, you in a pyramid scheme. Get out of that then. Get out of it. Because it doesn't make any sense. Because the pyramids, we don't use them no more. We all turn to boxes. Why? That's just what I got to say. If there's any questions, I'm about to close this out. Because I think I hit my level of talking. Yeah, I did it. So if you have any questions, next Thursday I have a guest speaker, and we're gonna further talk about the credit score and what it really is. So that's next Thursday. Hit me up, you guys. I'm gonna leave in the description box the two jobs I talked about, Forex and Econ. In my econ, and let's try to help each other start investing. Let's try to give each other reasons to invest. Oh, we got friends in their small businesses, you guys. Invest in your friend's small business, and your friends who have these small businesses. This is why I gotta talk about this real quick. You people with these small businesses, and your friends are supporting you. Say I'm making t-shirts, and my friends are constantly buying my t-shirts, at least bought one of my t-shirts. Use your friends as promotions to thank them. So when you get older and you get more money, you get up in your business, start to grow and stuff, you can actually say, hey, I was helping them. And then that business is going to help you grow. Because your friends backed you up. Say what I mean by if I was selling remotes and my friend bought my remote, I'm going to say my friend bought my remote. And my friend's going to say I bought that remote from him. Or I bought that remote from her. That gives you communication. The businesses is talked about. And they're going to say, well, why did you need a remote? You say, well, I'm doing this in my business. Then those people now know about it. And then your friends who you got the remote from, then say, well, oh, what do they do now for their living? Oh, my friend that bought my remote, oh, they do this, and other. Then you got a large communication thing. You're not a pyramid work, you guys. You box, you know, you're growing taller in your box, you're growing. So in that understanding, I'm just saying, you guys, please be more grateful to your friends who are working hard to help you grow your businesses. Be more grateful. Be aware and show it. Don't just talk about, I'm just grateful, thank you. No, show your gratitude. Stop making these stupid memes and things of fake people who haven't even tested out your product. You should have friends by now that says, hey, I tested out your product, and they're willing to share your work. Like, when you reward them for that, because they're not your friends, right? If you don't reward your friends for helping you come up in the world. To me, a person that I'm helping come up in their business and you don't show me any type of gratitude. Like, I had this one person, they went from having a small business to having like a lot of people interacting with them. They went from having a lot of people interacting with them to begging for donations. But the whole time, all I was doing was literally promoting, put them on my website. Bought their stuff from them, promoted their stuff for them. Not at one point did they say, this person's been helping me do this. This person has been doing this. Not at one point did they say, thank you for trying to help me grow my business. They literally just started saying things like, everybody help us do this, help us do that. Ignore all the people who helped us up until this point. we've been, look what we doing, look what we got, and that shit's sad, y'all. That shit, that businesses gotta do better. Businesses must do better. Cause your clients, your customers, your employees, these are the people who are growing your business. Treat them better. I'm not saying give them money, not saying give them a piece of your company. I'm saying at least give them something, some kind of recognition that says, thank you for helping me get where I'm at, because I started from the bottom and now I'm here, and I did not get there by myself, because the top of the pyramid wasn't built by one man, or it would just be a straight line. The top of the pyramid was built by many, and it continued to be built so that the bottom could remain sturdy and the foundation could be sturdy so that the person at the top wouldn't fall. So what is the point? Even when you build a box, the people at the bottom had to start somewhere to build that box, y'all. So we got to start treating them better. Do better, y'all. Do better as small and large businesses. Do better. It's not a black or white or Chinese thing. We all as a people need to do better. Point blank. But anyway, this is dear to my heart. I just feel like we should treat each other way better. Because we living off the blueprint of the old work way. The mindset of the old way we used to work. The old corporation. The mindset of how monopolies and businesses should have formed. It's stupid to continue that way of thinking and knowing that it did not work. Because up until this point, if it was working, we wouldn't be in the situations we are now. So think about it. Let's not keep doing the same thing. Let's not keep being insane, doing the same thing over and over and expecting different results. Let's be different. So if you don't have any questions, if you do find questions in your reality later, hit me up in my inbox. Join me on Manifestational Energy Exchange. It's my website. It spells out the word me, M-E-E. You can follow me there. It's in the description, manifestationalenergyexchange.com. It's where I go to exchange energy, not just finances, because the dollar does not define all of us, you guys. There's other ways of exchanging, not just by the dollar. So we got different ways of growing, different ways of connecting. If you got a business you want, if you need, you want help in any of the growth of it, hit me up. I'm willing to help. If you see something on my page you want to be a part of, hit me up. I'm willing to put you on there. I do free promotions. It doesn't matter. Don't let your ego make you pay. My ego don't make me pay shit, because I'm not in the mood no more. I'm investing all my energy in myself. And my ego should only promote what I'm doing to improve myself, to increase myself, to increase my spiritual, financial, physical, mental, spiritual. It needs to increase that. I'm using my ego to invest instead of to give me and pay. So, if that's all, peace and love to you guys. Treat yourself how you want to be treated. Treat others how you want to be treated. If you was them, keep attaining knowledge, because knowledge is the only way we can get out this world with full understanding. Because this knowledge actually might be the only thing we can take with us. Because that's how you can remember when you reincarnate. But that's a whole different story. So I'm out. Peace and love. See you guys next Tuesday at 1 o'clock. Next Thursday at 1 o'clock. Tuesdays and Thursdays, 1 o'clock every day. But next Thursday, I'll see you guys then. Hopefully. Never know, you feel me?